This is PyJenkins CI, a Python continuous integration server. It allows you to use DevOps techniques in your Python apps. In a nutshell, DevOps is making a system which is self-testing and can be immediately deployed to production servers in under 15 minutes without worrying about configuration and integration issues. It's amazingly powerful, but if not done correctly, just enables you to push more bugs through quickly. The system allows you to automatically run linting, copy and paste detection, unit tests, code coverage, and performance testing. In a future video, I'll show you how to integrate system monitoring using Nagios and Snort, as well as automatic security scans using Gauntlet. Even these seemingly simple tests can help cover deeply flawed parts of your code. Linting could have prevented the Apple SSL bug, and unsafe function call detection could have helped prevent a Heartbleed. So, let's dive into it. The system has been tested to work with the latest versions of Mac and Ubuntu systems. On a Mac, ensure you have SSH enabled. Start by going to System Preferences, click on Sharing, enable Remote Login. In this case, I've only enabled myself. Next, make sure you've installed VirtualBox and Vagrant. VirtualBox allows you to run virtual machines on your local system. This is the same thing that helps power things like Rackspace, Amazon, and DigitalOcean. Vagrant is a Ruby system that allows you to automate the creation of VirtualBox VM machines. Next, git clone the project. Make sure you put it into your sites folder under your home path. So in this case, I'm here underneath my account, Paul Clark, and I have a folder here called sites. Once you have that going, go in and open up the folder / data. So here I'm using Aptana. You can use, go to PyJenkins CI, go to data, open up build.sh. Now the first few lines here, you notice I have host user and host pass. These are the usernames and passwords you use to log into your local system. In this case, I've just set it to Apollo Clark and Jenkins. Once you have that going, pull up a command line console, go into your sites folder, change directories into PyJenkins, change directory into Vagrant, and run Vagrant up. This will take roughly between 5 and about 15 minutes or so to run. What's going to happen is it's going to download a really fresh, clean install of Ubuntu, install all the needed dependencies we're going to need to run Jenkins, and set up Jenkins. So run the command, let it run, sit back, go for a walk, grab a drink, whatever. When you come back, you'll see outline output like this. You can see here it's all the various libraries we need to run the system. Once that's done, go to 127.0.0.1 port 8080. This is the Jenkins instance that will be set up for you. So you can see here, we have a default project called Discover Flask Vagrant. This is just a starter project. If you want to use this at your office, replace this with whatever system you're looking to test against. Click on the project, it'll be right here. By default, you won't see this. The charts you see on the right-hand side are from a previous run, but I'll show you how to run it in a sec. What's nice is, as I mentioned earlier, it'll go through, it'll do linting to find common code problems. It'll run your unit tests, tell you if there's any problems with that. It'll tell you what percentage of your code is being tested, in this case 95%, and what the response time is. These alone are really high level, very general things to test against your code, but will help you find amazingly robust and fatal flaws in your code. And finally, we run SLOC count, which basically tells you what percentage of your systems are Python, XML, shell scripting, Java, PHP, etc. So let's really dive in and look at what's happening under the hood here. So when you go into the Vagrant folder, and you run Vagrant up, the first thing it does is it looks for this Vagrant file. So you can see here it's running Ruby. This is all Ruby syntax, by the way. So it sets the version file. In this case, we're using Vagrant version 2. And goes to the configuration. So you can see here, I'm telling it to use Ubuntu/trusty64. If you go over here to Vagrant boxes, .es. It's a list of all the various machines you can pull in. So here you can go through if you want to use CentOS, Arch, Debian, whatever versions, you can put that in for yourself. In this case, I used Ubuntu Trusty Tar 64. Latest version is pretty stable. Next, I did port forwarding. So in this case, I say if I remember port 8080 in my host here in Mac, it'll go down to port 8080 within the Ubuntu machine I've created. So in this case, I'm doing a one-to-one. You can use different port numbers. You don't have to always use the same ones, which is nice. Next, I'm telling the Ubuntu machine, we're going to connect to a private network. I'll tell you why this actually matters in a little bit. But basically, I'm saying, create a private network called VBox Net Zero with a static IP address. The reason we do this is that by default, it'll use dynamic IP address, which means every time you run this, it'll be constantly changing. But if you want to have a stable test system, you need to have some things be static. Next, we say, within the Ubuntu machine, if you go to the /vagrant folder, so we're going to go and type vagrant SSH, and this will log us into the Ubuntu system. So you can see here, you know, Ubuntu 14.04, etc. So we're going to change directories to /vagrant. ls. So you can see your build.sh, discover flask, vagrant html, etc. This is the same thing you downloaded earlier on from GitHub. So in this case, I'm saying whatever's in this folder here, data, relative to build, will be attached to vagrant. So you can see all the files here are also here within the machine, the virtual machine. Next here, I'm saying if you're using VirtualBox, again, you may be using, you know, Amazon or Rackspace, etc. Using VirtualBox, go in and name the machine PyJenkins. So if you pull up VirtualBox, you'll see the machine I'm talking about. So here is PyJenkins. Finally, we say run configure VM provision shell. In this case, bootstrap.sh. So here we have the Vagrant file. And within the same folder, we have bootstrap.sh. So this is just a simple bash script. So you can see here in the top, we say, you know, user bin environment bash. So going through the script, you can see I installed the basics you need to compile various pieces of code, SQLite, etc. Next, I install Jenkins, start it up. And here's the fun part. I go through and actually install some of the most commonly used plugins. In this case, we're installing the performance, Kubernetes, violations, SLOC count, GitHub, etc. I wanted to make this as simple and easy for you as possible, so did everything automatically. Now here, we're creating a brand new project within Jenkins. So what I'm doing is I'm saying within the Vagrant Discover Flask Vagrant folder, copy that into var lib Jenkins jobs discover flask. So you can find that Discover Flask Vagrant folder right here. And this is literally just something I copied out of Jenkins that I installed earlier. But what's nice is it has everything you need to get started. Next, we go in and we set the folder permissions to 777. So that way, later on, we can SSH into this folder and copy files around. Once we have that, we restart, which will tell Jenkins to look for these plugins files and install them and set them up. Finally, we install JMeter. So what that lets us do is go into the project here, Discover Flask Vagrant, and hit Build Now. So I'm going to do that right now. Once you do that, a new build task will activate. You can see it building here. Click Console Output, and you can actually see what's running. So let's really dive deep into this. So one of the things I did with this was I said whenever we create a new project, run the build.sh file inside the data folder of PyJenkins CI. So earlier on when I had you install this, I had you put in your username and password. So we set that up. Now what PyJenkins will do is it'll go to the project folder first and remove any of the old test files. Next, this is the fun part. It'll call out from the Ubuntu machine up into your Windows, or in other cases, Ubuntu instance, and help run commands. So the reason I did this is that it's very atomic, and if you deploy this to the cloud, such as Amazon or Rackspace, you can replace this with your credentials you normally use to create other virtual machines on the system. So here we're using SSH pass, which I would not suggest using in production. I'm just using this for demonstration purposes. If you're using this for production, definitely, you know, correctly pass around your public-private keys. But for now, because I'm doing it locally and it's not publicly available, I'm using SSH pass. So I do that, and I log into 10.0.2.2. 10.0.2.2 is what VirtualBox uses by default as the host. So that's what you can log into. And I add the option here, TAC 0, strict host key checking equal to no. Now the reason I do that is that if you were to run this command by itself, you'll always have the pop-up interactively that will say, are you sure you trust this? By adding this option here, it'll say, go ahead and accept it. And I put in TAC T, TAC T. What this will do is it'll force a sudo TTY terminal. Technical detail, but you know, it helps make things go a little smoother. Now, in this case, the Ubuntu Jenkins instance is actually logged into your Mac computer, which is really cool. So what's nice is I say, okay, go into your sites folder, look for any folder named Discover Flask Test and get rid of it. And then git clone a second project called Discover Flask Vagrant. Now, Discover Flask Vagrant is actually a project that I slightly modified from Discover Flask. Discover Flask is a Python project that helps you learn how to use the Flask framework. It's a micro framework, so it's much more simple and compact compared to a larger framework such as Django. Django requires you to use very specific syntaxes and formatting for things. Flask basically has a plug-and-play system, so if you want to use things like SQL Alchemy, you can. If not, you can go and do it yourself. Anyways. I basically took that project and customized it to be compatible with Vagrant. So it says download the project, go into the Discover Flask Test Vagrant Test folder, and run Vagrant up. Again, exact same process as we did earlier to set up Jenkins. It just goes through, install all the dependencies. In this case, the dependencies will include the code testing tools, which you can see here. In this case, we're installing Pylint, Mock, Coverage, Nose, Nose, X, Cover, as well as Clone Digger. Once that's all set up, we save out the SSH key, which is nice that Vagrant can let you do this, and we save it to a file, and then we load that file up into SSH, and then we tell it, okay, go in and run this file, in this case, www.runtests.ssh, which you can find inside the Discover Flask Vagrant project under the WW folder, runtests.ssh. Really simple little thing. Goes through, runs Pylint, which will help you find basic code problems. It'll run nose tests. In this case, I'm letting it only run one file, test.py, instead of trying to automatically discover things. Heads up, this running nose tests can actually crash your system sometimes if things are not formatted correctly. So I added the flag TACH. I'm going to say TAC X, which will say if you find a problem, just quit. I find problems where you get runaway processes, so heads up on that one. Next, we run Clone Digger, which will find instances of copy and paste, which are really good targets for refactoring. Next, we'll run SLOC count, which will show you what percentage of your project is Python, PHP, Java, XML, etc. So, run all the tests and then copy them over into the test folder. So this is where I'm saying go to 192.168.1.2, and that's what we configured PyJenkins CI to be running on, which you can find right here. So using SSH pass, again, insecure, don't do this in production, but for now it works. Secure copy over the files, so you can see each of the files there. Once we're done, right, so if you want to customize this, definitely go for it. few other options and a few other ways you can do this and accomplish it. Give it a try. Some of them will crash, some of them will work. You'll figure it out. Anyways, once we're done the tests, we log out of the Mac machine. So now we're back into the Ubuntu instance running Jenkins. And we do a simple curl request. This will ensure that in the debug output that we can actually, you know, access the project. If things aren't configured correctly, this is a way to find out. You should be able to get an HTML page. So you can see here, I ran the tests, ran code coverage, and here's where I ran the curl request. So you can see the doc type, HTML, etc. That's where that command runs. Next, we run JMeter tests. JMeter is an Apache project. It allows you to do both stress testing and performance testing against your websites. And you can find that file inside the slash vagrant jmeter.jmx, or in this case, pyjenkinsci data jmeter.jmx. It's basically just a large XML file. So I definitely suggest downloading JMeter, the jar file, running it, and opening the file and customizing it using the user interface system a lot faster. And you can add as many tests as you want to this one, so feel free to go wild. The one I added for now is really simple. It says, go to the login page 100 times. That's it. Anyways, so that'll do performance testing. And then finally, we connect to the host, in this case Mac, again. And we say, go to the testing folder and destroy the virtual machine and shut it all down. So what's nice is this is all wrapped up into itself. So in the beginning, we say, create a new machine, clear things out, run the test. And then way at the end, we clear everything out. What's nice is after you're all done, on the console log here, you should see either finished success or finished failure. Now, if you see finished failure, many, many reasons that may happen, but I've set up this project to always succeed. So go up here, go to back to project. And what's nice is when you run this test two times in a row, you'll start seeing performance trends. So you can see for now it's all straight lines because I haven't changed anything between the tests. But what's great about this is as your project evolves and you get better at doing DevOps and unit testing and code coverage, your graphs will hopefully gradually increase. It's just really powerful. You know, it helps you really hone in and focus on, and it makes it visible to the whole team, you know, how good are we really doing? So yeah, in a nutshell, that's what PyJenkinsCI does. Again, in the future, I'm going to show you how to integrate other tools. I want to show you how to integrate things like Selenium, so you can test browser testing. You can also integrate things like Nagios. Nagios is good for doing high-level performance testing against servers. Things like, you know, what is your latency to response? What is your CPU usage? How much memory are you using, etc. These are very high-level stats, but they're good to just kind of find problems really early on. And then I'll finally show you how to do things like Snort, which will actually help you detect attacks against the server. And finally, Gauntlet. Gauntlet's a very interesting system. It helps you automate doing system scans. So right now, normally I use Kali Linux to do scans manually. But with a system like Gauntlet, it lets you use a file format called Cucumber. I like to think of it as kind of like YAML. You know, it's a really simple little file format, but it allows you to automatically script things like Nmap, SSL Analyzer, Cross-Site Scripter, SQL Map, SQL Ninja, etc. Very powerful. I'll explore that in future videos. So check it out. Let me know if there's any kind of issues with it as far as settings or anything like that goes. I'd love to hear your feedback. You know, I'm really hoping that this project will help you learn how to do continuous integration, continuous delivery, for your Python projects. What really motivated me to do this was I was trying to make something like this for my office, and I looked out there to see, you know, what's out there, and unfortunately there's really not much. Honestly, as far as the language goes, Python is rather immature as far as continuous integration tools go compared to things like definitely Java or, you know, C++ and PHP. You know, with those systems you have many, many other options. With Python, we're still getting there. Down here in the bottom, you can see some of the references. These are various websites I use to learn other systems that were available. So yeah, give it a try. Let me know what you think. Thank you.